Then, without taking any more time, we get to introduce Carnegie Brass. The gentlemen who are here to play for you are graduates of our school. We bring them every year. We try to get them back into the room to play. They toured all over the world. It's a crowd of outstanding musicians with a wonderful Carnegie Mellon pedigree. And without taking any more time, I'm happy to introduce Carnegie Brass. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
First thing you'll hear is the flugelhorn playing this kind of, I don't even know the musical term for it, honestly, but it's a kind of a decoration, an independent melody. Then somewhere in the middle will come the song itself that they pass it around. The trombone, I believe, was the first one to actually just play the simple song. And everybody else is decorating around that very nice melody. I think it's a beautiful piece, and I think you'll agree. This is the Sleepers Awake, otherwise Wake Up. So here it is.
Thank you. go on to careers or to study to be professionals. But what you're seeing here is what we call chamber music. I'm sure you know that. It's small groups. And probably the most enjoyable, I think if you were to talk to any, you know, musician, experienced, skilled musician, they're probably going to tell you that this is, for them personally, the most enjoyable combination. I don't mean a brass quartet, but I just mean a small group. Like a trio or a quartet or just anything smaller than five or six people. That enables a whole lot of democracy, a lot of personal expression, and a lot of chance to play what you want to play. And I think that's just a kind of a bit of advice there for you. Should you continue on, find a small group, and I'm not telling you what to play at all. As a matter of fact, you and your group decide, and always make sure you play stuff or you sing stuff that you simply love to play. That's a really critical thing, because this kind of group will probably, a small group will probably never be your full-time job. You'll play in a symphony orchestra, you'll be teaching choir at a huge school somewhere, and this will be your chance to do stuff that you really like to do and enjoy and have a pretty interesting experience at it. So if you write your own arrangements and you pick your own music, this next one, anybody that's played any band music here knows this composer, Ralph Vaughan Williams. This is probably his most famous work, very prolific English composer around the time of the Second World War. This is the first movement of his English folk song suite. Vaughan Williams loved folk music, and he just was all about it. And he loved it so much that he arranged over 850 folk songs. That's a whole lot, I don't even know that many of them. But he took them and he fixed them up and he made them into some fun and exciting music. So this is very much the standard repertoire for band music and even orchestras around the world. This is the first movement of his English folk song suite.
Thank you.
open to your questions or any thoughts you have concerning what we're doing or anything about our careers. I just want to be done. We're seeing at a whole lot of different venues. You're seeing a group of five musicians coming together today performing this chamber music. But each one of these individuals performs and teaches in a whole lot of settings. I'm going to try, I'll probably forget some of this as I go, but I wanted to introduce each of the players to you and give you kind of a little sketch about what they do in their lives and how we patch it all together to make a career and a living out of being a musician. Because as I've already mentioned, chamber music, it's very rare that chamber music will be your full-time job. If you do, congratulations, but it's a big world out there. So David Mika, our French horn player, is the principal horn of the River City Brass Band. For you from out of town, Pittsburgh has a unique group. It's a professional brass band. It tours around the country, and it's a fantastically high quality musical group in its own respect. He also plays with the, if any of you have seen the Civic Light Opera, the shows that come to town, the Broadway shows, he plays in the orchestra for those as well. He also teaches at the Upper St. Clair School District, which is out south of here. Mr. Jeff Nicodemus is also with the River City Brass Band, and he also plays pit orchestras around the region. If you ever come to see a show, a professional show, always take a walk down to the pit and see you here. You may recognize one of these individuals. He also teaches in the
Pine Richland
School District, which for you out of towners is just north of the city. Next to him is Mr. Bernie Black. He also is a principal solo cornetist with the River City Brass Band. Like the others, he also plays a number of engagements with orchestras, pit orchestras, etc., around the region. And his one of his jobs, he's the chair and the head of the music department at the Performing Arts School here in Pittsburgh. We call it CAP, Creative and Performing Arts. I don't know where you're from, if you have a performing arts school in your city. Some do and some don't. But we have a pretty famous one. It's very successful and very proud of it. And so he chairs and organizes the activities there. Next to him is Carl Jackson. Carl Jackson, we're all Carnegie Mellon graduates, by the way. Carl has made his career playing in vastly numerous numbers, probably one of the most active freelancers in the city, if not in the country. I can't begin to tell you all of the things he has played and does play, but suffice to say that he's currently mostly playing with Johnny Angel. Johnny Angel and Halos. He plays a lot of oldies with a horn band that does, again, a whole host of other activities as a player. Extreme versatility is what I can tell you. I think that would be the lesson I learn every day from Carl, is to be able to fit into any kind of setting. Because if you all of a sudden decide, well, I only play Johnny Halo, then you're not going to play in a brass quintet. And so his versatility shines every day that he plays. And he also teaches at Capital School, I mentioned earlier. On tuba today is Mr. Phil Vanus. Phil Vanus, also a Carnegie Mellon person, plays with the Pittsburgh Opera. You familiar with the Pittsburgh Opera? Come and see him sometime. And anybody that goes to hear the Pittsburgh Ballet, you will also run into Phil Vanus. Magnificent player, again, of great versatility. So we're very happy to have him here playing today. He's playing a small instrument. Phil, I noticed myself, tuba players play all different kinds of instruments. What kind of instrument is that?
It's a tuba. It's used in British brass bands. It's the key of E flat. Like River City Brass Band is kind of British style brass band. There's four tubas. So they have two of these and two B flat parts.
Two, it's an E flat, yeah. So it's pitched in E flat. So you non brass players would wonder what that means. It just means that you'll notice that the size of the instrument, the quality of the instrument changes, as you probably noticed when Mr. Black played the flugelhorn. So anyway, we're going to jump on further here to a genre of music that we all really like. Juan Carlos Jobim came out of the 60s and created a real sensation of creating a style of music that was from Brazil. And to this day, people still love it. We certainly do, and I'm sure you've probably heard this tune either sung or arranged a million times because it's such an enjoyable piece of music. We don't have a drummer here today, but you can imagine the soft Latin style of the drum set playing along with this piece. This is Jobim's The Girl from Ipanema.
These aren't all the instruments that we play. As far as brass instruments, even as far as that goes, we probably have more. We each will play piccolos on certain things. Sometimes we'll have equally the amount of trumpets here in different pitches. I know Carl and Phil also play euphoniums and baritones, other higher and bass trombones, those kinds of things. Other than that, I think we probably all play piano and that kind of thing too, but they're not on stage.
One slab is hard.
Right.
So you said that like many of you have other jobs besides the performance. Would you suggest doing like a double major or something like that?
Absolutely.
In college? Because of that?
Absolutely. Yeah. If you want to get into like your voice major?
Yeah.
Okay, voice. Even like arts management or something like that. There's always going to be some need for like management skills. Orchestras or whatever.
Well, it doesn't have to be in music.
Right.
You can be, you study physics. When we were in school here, I remember I used to get upset because there was this like really good trumpet player. He was a computer engineering major. It was like, that wasn't fair. But the fact is that talent and hard work is
big.
Yes.
We should point out, though, that all of us are involved strictly in music, even though we do other things. We are all involved strictly in music.
Yes.
But not to say that it's not a good idea to double major. I'm sorry, where?
You only did one major.
We did, yeah.
Yeah.
But it's times are different now. You need to be very versatile. It's you know, when we were at Carnegie Mellon, the idea was that you get your music ed degree, you get a performance degree, and you go out and try to make the best that you can in music and hopefully have a teaching job and a playing job too, which worked out for us. But times are not like that anymore. Now there's no guarantee that you're going to get a teaching degree or teaching job. You might get a degree, but you can't get a job. The same with playing. For us, symphony orchestras are just a dying breed. So you can't count on getting a job like that. So being as versatile as you possibly can, even if it's not music related, just will help you. You don't really need a piece of paper, really, for someone to tell you how well you play. That's really not what gets you the opportunities when it comes to playing. How you play gets the opportunities, networking with that. But just as much as you can possibly do when you're done will prepare you for, you know, future in the workforce.
Yeah, singing too. Yeah, please go ahead. College and all that stuff, but not necessarily. But here's the difference, and I think they would all agree. We all went to Carnegie Mellon, and I think we can pretty much say without any question that all of the contacts that we made, the connections we made in networking, and jobs, and opportunities came through here. Because after all, we met each other here, and we met so and so and so and so and this and that. So yeah, I think it matters to a certain extent. Yes. But it doesn't, like Mr. Black says, it doesn't guarantee that you're going to, you still got to be really on the top of
your game. The other thing, remember too, is like, we pick our teachers. I came here because Forrest Stanley was like one of the best French horn teachers in the country. Now, I'm not sure who teaches horn up at Harvard, but that's like a brand school.
Yeah.
But I don't know if I'm going to, you know, you right. Go for where your teacher is. It could be anywhere.
So you suggest have a lesson before deciding on
the teacher?
Yeah, a teacher. Have a lesson with a teacher and see what you think of him or her. Definitely.
My daughter's at Point Park, she's a theater major, and one of her best friends is now going to Christine on Broadway. And she, like, she's in the rotation of the four Christines or whatever. And she was just good, like, the way my daughter described it. She just had a great voice no matter where she's from. And she was so talented and so hardworking and so focused and so right on. You could be from anywhere if you have a voice like that. Yes.
What's your daughter's name?
Pardon? My daughter's name is Adrian Knapp. She's a senior in the theater. She's floating around there, ready to graduate in a year and get on with her life. My other daughter graduated from George Washington in theater. Talk about, like, George Washington's a brand school, but not really for theater. Depends. Although you're in a big city, maybe the best advice you can say is wherever you are, you ought to be where it's happening. Because if you're way out in the middle of nowhere, you may not be able to connect and have opportunities. For example, these folks here are on so many recordings you cannot imagine. And you'll never know. It's just like there's something that was recorded and they got called in to do the recording and it took, because they were close enough. They were in the proximity, they were in the area. So they were asked to do it because they could get into the studio, they could rehearse and prepare and do the recording and exit. Yes?
Music's taken us all over the world. You, of course, you can just buy an airplane ticket and go somewhere, but when you're playing and working and actually getting paid for it, and most of the time getting paid for it, some things don't pay so much, it's more the opportunity, but I would say music's provided the opportunity for all of us to see the world. It really has. And Carnegie Mellon was a lot part of that because of the networking.
Yeah, that's a very good point. Just so you know, in the future, I know I reflect, I have the same feeling. It's like, I can't believe I'm here in this city. And the reason why I am is because I'm playing, a musician. And that will always be fun for you. It's getting tough. Your touring is a rough thing. When you're younger, it's a lot easier. Like I mentioned, three of these gentlemen are going to fly down to Florida tomorrow and play a concert for 45 minutes. Turn around and come back. Think of the logistics of that. We were just talking to the young lady who likes French horn. Is Mr. Pekin's horn case? He doesn't have a detachable bell. There's a lot of complications like that. Luckily, if you're a vocalist, the instrument comes with you. You don't have to worry. But the critical thing of vocalists is staying out again. Being on the road is really tricky. Yes?
Hi, Mr. Black. I'm Steve Ellison.
How are you?
I'm good. I
can barely see you back there. I recognize the voice, though.
So anyway, so we're a few more pieces to play for you today, and I'm glad those are very good questions. I think that keeping a healthy, inquisitive approach to what you're getting into, you know in your heart and soul what you like, and that's important, but also be smart about the game, know where the work is, and how to get it, and where you're going to be needed, and how you can define yourself. Because if you look at like pop stars, well, how did Lady Gaga become who she is? Well, she has a conservatory degree. She's very aware of her techniques and her fact. You know, everything's well planned and well produced, and she's right on top of it. So when you think of people and profiles, think in terms of where did they come from and how would they define their careers in whatever they're doing. This next one is comes. We're all uniquely American, and one part of our American heritage comes out of the early 20th century. We're talking about jazz. And the whole evolution of blues and jazz, and particularly, the interesting thing you may not know is that these instruments are some of the earliest jazz instruments, and there's a reason for that. It's a very simple reason. The tuba is the original jazz bass instrument, etc. The reason why is because after the Civil War, there were 28,000 brass band instruments in the Civil War, and all those brass band instruments, the war was over. They piled up in warehouses, and they finally started just giving them away. And so a lot of young musicians were just given brass instruments. One is Louis Armstrong. He was in a home for orphans, and someone came up to him and said, here, here's an old Civil War cornet. And it turns out that he turned it into an amazing career. So this music that we call jazz has its roots in a lot of very unique places. It particularly adapts well, obviously, to the brass instrument. Another very simple reason, it's portable. We can carry this instrument all around. We can play in the rain, we can play in the hot sun in the corners of New Orleans, or we can play in the symphony hall. So it's kind of rugged in that respect, so it's survived. We think of modern jazz with the piano and saxophone, but truly its roots came from brass instruments just like these. So this is the Sugar Blues. It's a great old blues style piece, and it employs some techniques that Mr. Black will show with, I think, what do they call that?
Growling.
Growling, yeah, it's a lot of different stuff like that.
I don't have the funky mute, but I'll use my hand.
Yeah.
Thank you.
These are two pieces that were actually found in an attic in Boston. Burying music in a landfill or something. You may find that as you go through your career, that music is discovered. A lot of times people say that Felix Mendelssohn discovered Bach. So we think, oh, Bach, everybody plays Bach. But there's a period when he's kind of forgotten. And if you notice, as you learn and grow as a musician, that some very unique niches and genres of music have been brought out, sometimes by accident. People taking something like a blues tune like that and doubling the time of it and making it faster, just adding another twist, arranging that piece for voice, etc. So you, in your versatility and looking for unique opportunities, they exist, and but they're out there somewhere. And here's a good example, two pieces we're going to play. I mentioned the brass bands in the Civil War. Someone, like I say, 20 years ago, found these in a footlocker in an attic and published them and pulled them out and adapted and fixed them up, and they were all called the American Brass Band Journal. So just for a moment, cast yourself back in time. Very strange phenomenon brass bands were in the Civil War, because they were actually for entertainment. And that's pretty strange to think that two sides of the conflict would be fighting and the brass bands would be entertaining the people watching. It's very bizarre, but nonetheless part of our history. And it also, they would use it to entertain the troops, so the brass bands would play all over the place. And these are two dances that were very popular at the time. One's called the Allemande Quick Step, and the other is...
It's the Yankee Doodle and Lily Bell.
Oh yeah, Yankee Doodle, which you know, and then the Lily Bell Quick Step. It's a little quick dance that people would dance back around the mid-18th century. Folks for coming out, and we hope that you're able to take with you throughout the rest of your summer and your career. This is an epic piece to end on, but it's a lot of fun. We'll play this in our summer series concerts for entertainment, for festivals, and so forth. And what it is, it's called Instant Concert. The guy that arranged it was the director of the Golden Man in Central Park, New York. There's a famous band that plays. He put this piece together, and it's little quotes and little like snippets of a whole lot of music, a whole lot of tunes. So try to follow along, and it's like a musical joke, because you'll hear the beginning of a song, and it turns into another song, and then the trombone will play a funny song. So it's just this whole mishmash of pieces all played together, and we call it Instant Concert. Again, thanks for coming. Should you have any more questions or for the musicians, please feel free afterwards to come down and have a talk. We'd be happy to talk to you. Thank you.
Thank you guys.